I appreciate that. Just
nuclear codes.
Sure. Okay, we're ready. Yeah, we're good.
Cool. Hi, welcome to the new Speakers Corner 2.0 as of COVID restrictions. I have with me the lovely Steve, obviously, and Ben, as we like to call him, to his face. So, on that bombshell, we three are going to discuss atheism, ostensibly, you know, us attacking, Steve defending for as long as he can under the onslaught of Ben's logic. And I'll let Ben open.
Okay, so Steve, as an atheist, I would ask you to account for me two things, the laws of logic and absolute truth.
Oh, goodness sake.
Because, start with this
because let me give you the reason why.
I'm going to be
come a bit closer, just case
Steve.
So the reason why I ask you, and you can push back at this if you like, but the reason why I ask, you know, in questions in regards to the laws of logic and absolute truth, because within the Christian worldview, within our paradigm, we can account for things such as absolute truth, morality, the laws of logic, because we believe the source of these things comes from God. So in your perspective as an atheist, where do you account for these things?
So before I say anything about my perspective or stance, tell me more about your theistic view of the laws of logic.
Okay, so I believe the laws of logic are transcendental. So
what does that mean?
Okay, they transcend the human mind, basically, okay? So if I was to ask you, as an atheist, do you believe the laws of logic are a construct of the human mind?
No, absolutely not, because they would exist even if humans didn't exist.
I agree. So in that case...
You don't need a theistic God.
No, I agree. They would still exist without any human minds. Mm-hmm. Now, how do you account for these things, like absolute truth? How do you account for absolute truth
without
an objective standard by which to appeal to?
Well, I'm going to go back to you and seek clarification on what's absolute truth.
Absolute truth, something that is absolutely true and not subjective.
Can you define it without just reordering the words?
Absolute truth, something is universally true without variation. For example, you said that the laws of logic would still exist even without the human mind. That's something that is absolutely true. Universally true.
According to you two.
Universally
my
true.
Definition.
My individualistic perspective, subjective view on it is that they
Give me your money.
My definition of absolute truth is something that is a perfect example of reality. That's it, basically. It's
perfect.
The epitome.
So how
no,
can
absolute
you know
truth.
Did you say perfect?
Yes, because absolute is the highest.
Be
no, not perfection is the descriptor. Oh. It's a perfect example because absolute truth, not 99% truth, absolute is a perfect example.
I cannot say from my own personal perspective that absolute truth exists.
But you can say it exists independent of the human construct.
I cannot personally
say let me ask you.
That it does exist.
Okay, so absolute truth, there's no such thing as absolute truth.
I didn't say that. I didn't say there's no thing. I said from my individualistic subjective view, I cannot demonstrate or prove that absolute truth, i.e. 100.0%.
Is that statement absolutely true?
No, because it's an individualistic subjective view.
Okay, but when you say I can't...
You see, my world perspective differs to your world perspective because I go with the subjective more and you go with the objective more.
But do you recognise that there is an objective source? Let me put
no.
it to the... Okay, then let me give you an example.
So that means the big...
Not necessarily. No, it just means there's something from which it comes, which we've semi.
I'm glad you said something, not someone.
Yes, well, God is also something. Excuse me, but I would still be finishing my sentence. So, for example, Nazi Germany in the 40s and Britain in the 40s.
Yes.
We, as subjective moralists, the Brits believed that we were correct in condemning the Germans for their actions. And the Germans believed they were correct
from
in their actions.
From a certain point of time,
from the subjective,
did,
and in the 40s, that's why I gave you a temporal.
But again, you're being
identified.
Absolute.
Let me finish my point, though.
Hitler's view on bread baking may have been
excellent.
Perfectly legitimate.
That's fine. I'm talking about nationally, their policies towards the Jews and the Brit and the Allies'
so
policy.
Well, now we're being
we're talking
specific.
About, no, but I haven't even got
narrowing
to the end.
It down.
So, those are two moral stances. The Nazi
gassing
party
Jews
says, yes, we
Jews.
Shall kill them, it's legal. The Allies say, no, that's morally incorrect
yep.
and illegal.
Yep.
But if there is no objective outside standard to measure both... Wait
which,
a minute.
Which
wait, no,
isn't.
It's an if. So you have to go along with my narrative for a moment. if there is none, then it is pointless for me to say, as a member of the Allied Party, then you are wrong. Because
it's not pointless.
The
lack of absolute truth does not make a perspective
so
pointless.
So to what do you appeal? How do you explain to the Nazis that it's incorrect when they have asserted confidently this is correct for us?
By my own individualistic, subjective, moral standpoint, which I try to persuade and hope other people share to a degree.
Hitler was very open to persuasion.
That's the problem.
And human beings.
Steve, that's
all species.
That's the problem.
Can you say that Nazism was wrong in the 40s?
I can. Okay. As an individual with a subjective view.
Because you have an external barometer.
No, I don't.
Wait. Well, I'm going to let me finish a sentence, and you might know what you're refuting.
It's always been difficult.
If I steal your wallet, yeah, we both know. Presumably, we both, when you say, hey, give me that back, it's mine, I know that by you saying it's mine, that means you should possess it and I'm incorrect for taking it. But that's, no one ever says, what do you mean? What do you mean it's yours? Like, it's not that the mugger doesn't understand.
The rules of ownership are fairly obvious, aren't they?
Not necessarily.
But again, even with the rules of ownership, there are exceptions.
And what are they based on? The rules of ownership?
If I was a billionaire and you were absolutely your wit's end and poor and nothing to eat, then that's very different.
There's a different rationale behind it, but it's still theft.
So what you said is you would try to persuade them.
It's not black and white.
Steve, you said that you would like... Steve, you said you would like to persuade them based upon your subjective view.
Yes.
But the problem is, that's what both sides are going to do. You're going to say to the Nazi you're going to say to Nazi Germany, I'm going to try and convince you based upon my subjective morality that what you're doing is wrong. They're going to come back at you and say, well, based upon our subjective morality and the standard we appeal to, we believe it's absolutely okay to do. So I'm saying, when you have these two conflicting subjective moralities, Which external objective source do you appeal to?
There isn't one.
That's the problem. So you have a worldview that's subjective, which ultimately the atheist is being inconsistent. Because when you say
I'll show you how.
Because when you say okay, repeat what you said because people interrupting.
People.
Where's the inconsistency in the atheist?
It's inconsistent.
What is specifically?
I'm about to show you.
The atheist.
Okay, 1 second. The atheist saying these things, okay, is inconsistent.
Same
because
things.
I'm going to get to it, Steve. Because when you say, okay, this is what we have, it's subjective, and that's what we go with, you're then going to say, when Nazi Germany kicks down your door, drags you and your wife and kids away, you're then going to say that's absolutely wrong. So then you're going to appeal to an absolute truth, not a subjective opinion.
You're choosing, deciding what words I'm going
to
use.
So if they kicked to make your point. So if they kicked in your door, would you say it's absolutely wrong? Then kicking your door.
I tend not to use the word absolutely. Full stop.
Absolutely.
But listen, do you not see the point though? No, because again, as I said ages ago, in this conversation, you work in a world of absolutes, objectives. I don't.
Let's move on.
Does your faith make something variable. True? The fact that you believe in something very vehemently
makes it true. The truth inspires the faith.
Well, you're not right just because you believe in something. Nobody has claimed that.
But Pavlov, that's not what we're saying. Truth is that which corresponds to reality. Would you agree?
Yeah, but what you believe is reality.
Sorry?
Not necessarily.
What you believe reality is.
Someone could say this horse head is beautiful.
But that's in the terms of subjective.
What you believe reality is necessarily reality.
You're making a false dichotomy.
Reality has
saying
to come
from
the lens of subjectivity
or the objective,
as in human interpretation.
There are things that are subjective.
But your eyes are objective.
I haven't finished.
Flavour.
So it gets to your brain, and then you make the judgment.
In terms of morality and the laws of logic,
as to how closely that relates to the truth.
Well,
as
why
you perceive
then?
It. And yet,
I'm not sure how this is going to work on camera.
Sorry, what we're claiming is that there is an objective standard, not reality. How then does morality change, evolve, alter? If what you've just said is correct, morality is absolute and objective,
why therefore does morality change both geographically and with time? What my mother found immoral, I find perfectly fine. What my mother found moral, her mother, my grandmother, found absolutely immoral. And what we find moral here, a Muslim culture, for example, would find absolutely immoral. So, and it's not just religion-based. So morality clearly varies with time and space.
It varies in time and space when you have a worldview that is without God. For example,
religious societies change. The Catholic Church changes its stance on morality.
They do. That's because they're inconsistent. Okay. For example,
bad Christians.
They're inconsistent in terms of, for example, the Pope said that the capital punishment is now wrong, when prior popes said that's okay. That's because they're basing that on the opinion of a man who's running that particular institution. Rather than the laws of God themselves, because if we live by the laws of God, then things are absolute. If we go by the laws of man, then things become subjective, like Nazi Germany, like Mao Zedong.
So therefore, points me in the direction of a single faith or religious clan who've been unwavering in their beliefs and their morality, has not changed at any point during history.
Okay, so now what you've done is you've committed a fallacy of composition. You're basically saying because the engine is blue, therefore the whole car is blue. I'm saying simply because those people within this faith wander from the truths that God has revealed in his word, doesn't therefore logically follow that the faith itself is then subjective.
You're making a claim in regard to absolute objective morality that you claim to get from your creator, and that it's unchanging, and you're saying everything I'm saying about but morality changes with time and with the geography, you're saying but no, if you've got the absolute morality from your creator, it's unchanging. So therefore I'm asking, which I think is a reasonable question, asking for some evidence or examples of where that can be demonstrated.
Okay, so evidence. Let's look at evidence, okay?
Of where morality has been unchanging throughout time, throughout history, and across geography.
Okay, so I'm granting you that depending on different societies, morality has become subjective. For example, a classic case is Nazi Germany. Their subjective morality said it's okay to do these hideous things. We over here said, well, that's not okay to do, therefore we must put a stop to that. So what I'm saying is, when we do that, when we say it's absolutely wrong to murder these people, we are borrowing from the Christian worldview. When we say that's wrong because they that's wrong because they have value. So I'm saying, in terms of societies making up different subjective moralities, I agree they do that. So that's my answer there. They do that, absolutely. But the problem is, it doesn't therefore logically follow that absolute truth does not exist. Because in the paradigms I'm speaking in terms of worldviews, under the Christian worldview, absolute truth is definitely a thing. Absolutely.
But there doesn't seem any evidence for it being...
Which is going back to my point. Evidence, okay, I would say evidence presupposes proof. Would you agree? Evidence presupposes proof.
Mm-hmm.
Proof presupposes truth. Because you can't prove something to be true if it's not true. So proof presupposes truth. Truth presupposes God. Because without God, where do you get truth from?
I have to say, what the most ridiculous statement ever. Okay, where do you get truth?
Explain to me, how do you get truth without God? Because this goes back to what you said earlier.
Because, you know, can I say first, though? I think that one of the very first things we said over there was that the laws of logic exist whether humans exist or not.
And that's my point.
Okay, wait. So we both agree on that point. Well, my friend, the laws of logic or the laws of morality or whatever else you want to pick exist whether your God exists or whether that man over there's God exists or whether that woman's multiple gods over there exist.
Steve, I'm saying these things exist because God exists.
You're not getting any evidence.
Okay, so that's why we look at the presuppositions through which we're looking at the world, and we determine which one of our presuppositions makes more sense and which one doesn't. Because I can say...
Right and everyone else is wrong.
It's not. I'm asking you to critique your presuppositions, okay? That's what I'm asking you to do. Because, as I've said, you agree, and I'm glad you do that, because many atheists actually tell me,
we're not one church.
We're not one organisation.
We're all individuals.
Steve, one second.
More than any other group.
Many atheists tell me, that no, they only exist in the, you know, the construct of the human mind. So I'm glad you're a bit more consistent and say, well, no,
well, they, that more they
one second, you're saying consistent. You're it's consistent and inconsistent. Let me explain why. Because you're saying that they will still exist, okay, without God. I'm saying yes, they do. Actually, not without God, without people.
You were right. The first
without
time.
People. I'm saying yes, they do still exist without people. But that therefore proves they're transcendental. They transcend the human mind. Therefore, they come from somewhere else.
Why does something transcending the human mind mean they come from somewhere else? Why?
So, okay, if they,
you're making links
Steve,
without
one second,
any.
Let me explain why. Let me finish the point. Okay. So if they exist without the human mind, they transcend the human mind, which means they come from somewhere other than us.
No.
I'm saying one second. So they don't come from somewhere
a
other
baboon,
than us.
A baboon transcends the human mind. That's no more evidence that the baboon came from somewhere else.
Okay, Steve. Let's not.
You're not making sense. Let's not
compare ourselves with baboons.
Why not?
Well, okay, one second. So let me continue my thought.
They're very similar.
Paul, okay.
You never watched baboons.
Steve, sorry.
You've never watched baboons?
I have, yeah. So,
they're very similar.
Well, only to some people.
The social societies, the interactions,
okay, but Steve,
the communication,
Steve, let me finish
the
my
childcare.
Point. Steve, let me finish my point, okay. So
they
I
do a better so, job so, than so, us so, in many ways.
Steve, so you're digressing. So I say, okay, that these things exist because of God. Therefore, they transcend us. So they come from a transcendental. One second. They come from a transcendental being. That's why I say I can account for these things based upon my presupposition that God is real. You can't account for these things. And I'm asking you to account for these things.
What? Baboons?
No.
Consciousness?
No, you're not following. Explain to me.
Logic?
Give an account.
Morals?
Give an account for things like truth, the laws of logic. All these things, account for those without a transcendental being.
Why do you need a transcendental being? Why do you need it?
Do you know why?
Why?
Because you said they exist without the mind. So if they
the human mind.
No, I'm saying the mind.
Humans are a tiny pinprick of existence.
I'm saying the mind.
Humans are a tiny pinprick
I'm
of
saying,
existence,
I'm
both
saying,
historically
I'm
and
saying,
again.
When I say mind, I'm talking about human mind and animal mind. So without those things, how do you account for these truths and the laws of logic? Because like I say,
that grass is grass, whether you and I exist or not. That statement kind of is an example of what you're saying.
Things that
exist outside of us,
Steve,
and unrelated to us, although we planted this grass and we mow this grass.
You're wrong.
But that the existence of that grass in no way demonstrates the existence of your creator.
Steve, the existence of that grass.
Very weak argument.
You saying that grass is green, okay, and that's grass with or without us. Yes, it is, but you need the construct of the human mind to determine what's green.
No, you need the rods in your back of your eyes,
which
your
comes
retinas.
From which come from human beings. Yes,
so without not just human
so
beings.
So without
okay, do you really, we've come from
living beings. Yes, so without the living beings here on Earth, with no God, where do you get these things from? You're still yet to answer.
So now you're moving it on to how we came about.
No, it's the same thing.
Well, you just said they come about.
No, no. Not us, how we come about, how these laws come about.
What laws?
Have you been here the whole conversation? The laws of logic, absolute truth, these things. I'm saying, with God I can account. You're saying,
the law of logic, what other laws are you referring
Steve,
to?
Steve, you're saying, okay, the law of non-contradiction.
These are philosophical.
Yes, they are.
Argumentations.
This is a philosophical argument. If you don't wish to continue, we can shake hands and that's fine.
I think we'll do that.
But think about that, because you
could. But to be honest, though,
you couldn't give an account
even,
for it.
Even if I wanted to be genuine and give you some time and go away and think about what we've just discussed, I'm going to really struggle to grasp what the hell you were talking about.
Okay. Can I give you some recommendations on reading?
Is it short and snappy?
Probably not.
Then it probably would be a waste of time.
Cheers.
Nice one. Good stuff.
Oh, very nice.